name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. Amen. Father in heaven, we give our utmost gratitude to you for the lives of everyone present in this momentous occasion. In this recital and exhibition of our students' talents, we pray that you always remind us that everything we do is for the greater glory of your name. We pray that we give justice to the Father of all arts and artists, that is you. We pray that you give us the strength and courage that we need to continue in producing beautiful masterpieces, and that we always use our gifts for the benefit of others and to bring you pride as your worthy sons and daughters. As we celebrate art, may you let us find joy and learning through the artworks that we are about to experience. We thank you that despite the difficult situation that we are experiencing, you've made way for us to continue fulfilling our life's purposes. We pray for good health and safety, for healing of the unwell, and for the inner peace of the bothered. Bestow unto us your presence and may this event be a success. All this we ask in the loving name of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ. Our Lasallian prayer, I will continue, O my God, to do all my actions for the love of you. John Baptist de La Salle, pray for us. Live Jesus in our hearts forever. In the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. Amen.
The global pandemic has brought about drastic changes in our lives. Gatherings were banned, doors were closed, and we were limited in the comforts of our homes. Some might say it worse. For others, we were restricted only in the four corners of our screens. But for the beautiful minds of the creatives, this is not a limitation, rather, a discovery of new spaces. We have thought of countless ways to adapt to the challenges of our time, which years before were unthinkable. As a result, our community of artists has expanded to explore the digital horizon. What you're about to see is part of the 5 recital and exhibition series we present to showcase the concepts learned, skills developed, and real-life application and appreciation lessons from Art Genre Base ADT Unit Workshop Classes. These are AVID, DIKIT, TAMPA, ANYAG, and MAGIS. all of which refers to the word beauty. Witnesses today as the Arts and Design Track Unit of the De La Salle University Integrated School joins this artistic revolution. This is ANYAG.
Good evening, Mrs. Castro. This is Ms. Reyes, your son's homeroom teacher. I'm calling up to raise a concern regarding your child's lack of performance. I remember he did remarkably well last year. I'm quite worried. Is he all right?
Artwork that was most significant to me because of the challenge that came with it. In hindsight, the concept was actually rather ambitious. The process of covering the entire window, which was around the same size as me, 5'3" for reference, with thin yarn was a difficult endeavor considering how there's only one of me to do the entire window, and there was also a time limit of around 4 days since I had a lot of other requirements to do at the time. When I figured out that the best way for me was to weave it like I was sewing, it felt like figuring out the answer to a difficult math problem. From there, it became a matter of patience and a lot of back pain. The making of the artwork was an extreme test of willpower, and it meant something to me that I was actually able to finish it on time.
As Charles A.M. said, art resides in the quality of doing, and process is not magic. For me, I believe that both conceptualization and execution are equally important, since conceptualizing helped me bring all together my ideas and inspirations to form a solid concept for my installation art and even other artworks. Not only visually, but it also helped me consider the meaning and purpose behind my work. The execution, on the other hand, is essential in a way that it brings the art itself to life. Hence, when a concept is far more supreme than the execution, the power embedded on the details of the artwork becomes weak, and vice versa. Like, if an artwork is worth making, then it should also be worth giving one's full attention to both the concept and the execution of the work. While working on this art piece, I discovered that I have the potential to create great works, that I have the capability, that I am able to explore beyond my zone or what I am capable of doing. Since I do doubt myself whether if what I'm creating is good or not, or will others like it or not. And with this, I learned that there is no such thing as bad art. Everything takes time, practice, and effort, and we all have our own perspectives. Though, it's about how honest I am with myself and how my heart and soul will like what I have created.
The most significant aspect of my art process, I'd say, is the painting, because it was the most challenging part. The reason for this is I did the painting last. So I folded everything, put them together, and then painted it, which made it harder for me to paint every single crevice. So if you look in the crevices in the inside of the origami, it was still white. And also, since I used old test papers and scratch papers, it was also hard to cover up the scribbles of ink, all the writings on the paper. But nonetheless, it was also the most fun part of the process.
I am a very opinionated person, and I usually express it through my artworks. In every artwork that I make, I make sure that each of them has a purpose and that each of them has an important meaning behind it. Which is why the most significant part of my art process was conceptualizing. Thinking of the topic that is interesting and important enough to express my opinion on is the most important part for me, as this is the sole reason why I am making the art piece in the first place. For my installation art village, I chose the liberating topic of virginity and how it is a social construct to praise those who remain pure and shame those who choose to have sex before marriage. With this work of mine, I expressed my perspective on how a woman should not be valued based on their so-called purity, for the reason that it is their body and it is their choice to make.
Good day, I am Kyle Meralde from ADT 12A Laguna. And my installation art is entitled Estudiante. It aims to depict the phenomenon of the male gaze and its effects to young Filipino women, specifically students. The sheerness of the tool aims to represent how men see through the clothes of a woman, more so a child, to sexualize her, no matter how covered up she is. The most significant aspect of my art process is the very fact that I am not skilled in creating 3D art. To be honest, I am not very proficient in making any large-scale 3D works, more so installation art. However, I really enjoy sewing and making clothes. Because of this, I decided to integrate this skill into the creation of this artwork, so that the art making process would be more aligned to my interests and skill set.
Hi, I am James Gareth Gomez from the Creative Writing Stream. The excerpt I am about to read is part of an essay I wrote about the first few days and months of the lockdown last year. It is an example of a personal essay. The personal essay is a genre of creative nonfiction that centers the writer's individual expression. The more particular you make the experience, the more fully a reader will feel the personal story along with you. The personal, when properly rendered, is universally significant. Michel de Montaigne, the French philosopher who is credited for the idea of the essay, said, "Every person has within them the entire human condition." This is the year the earth stood still. It was March 11, 2020, a Wednesday, the day that changed everything. Malacañang announced a suspension of all schools. It was a school night like any other. The group chats were filled and my phone dinged nonstop. Everyone had their concerns, not so much about the global pandemic, but about the sudden suspension of classes. So is our moving up cancelled? Solid 2-week suspension! Paano kaya test natin? These were some of the many reactions of my friends that night. One even got away from a pending school suspension that should have started the next day. I, like so many of my friends, was overjoyed by all of it, ignorant of the fact that our lives would change dramatically after that night. I was always outgoing and would hang out with people every weekend, so I was fortunate enough to have still went out with a few friends that weekend 2 days after the suspension. Little did I know that that would be the last in more than a year. The following week, the president announced the implementation of a nationwide quarantine, to which my friends and I at the time didn't take all that seriously. We thought that it would be over in a matter of weeks. So there we were, ignorantly calling each other, playing our games, and watching our series, unfazed by the reality of the ongoing situation that we thought would only last a few weeks. Then, the extension of the quarantine happened, and the reality and seriousness of the situation started to break the ignorance that we had been building up the past few weeks. All the plans that we intended started to become more and more unrealistic. My mother had to stay in the hotel since she was working in the interest of the safety of the family. So the errands that involved going outside fell to me as the only guy in the house. And as I stepped out the confinements of my home and ventured out the streets, and although I supposedly knew this already, I was still shocked to see the once noisy and crowded streets had not a single civilian in sight, just a few soldiers patrolling the entrance. It finally hit me. Everything has changed. Thank you.
Good day, I'm Josh Denzel-Nung from the Creative Writing Stream. The excerpt I'm about to read is a simple but unlikely tale of a camaraderie between a 4.5 by 4.5 inch white yeast and a 5'8 human being, me. This essay is called a personal essay with some elements of food writing, two genres of creative nonfiction. The personal essay and food writing could be closely linked, while the personal essay uses the first-person perspective and highlights the writer's distinct voice and style. Food writing can also be quite personal. As notable Filipino food writer Doreen Fernandez said, writing about food is not a matter of dipping into the thesaurus to discover the many ways to say tasty. Instead, it means digging deep into human experience because tasting, eating, and savoring are very intimate ventures. They occur within the person involving memory, sensation, and pleasure. While the personal essay in food writing could be about lofty, serious, or grand ideas and themes, I chose to write about something unserious and unexpected that would capture my style as a personal essayist and a food writer. This is a fateful encounter. I hated white bread. I never really understood the appeal of a 4.5 by 4.5 inch white yeast sponge or the inclusion of the overwhelming processed additives that comes with the package of eating such a symmetrical monstrosity. Also, chemistry reveals there exists no actual purpose for consuming the white sponge except when you desire your blood sugar to chive or if you want all the side effects that comes with type 2 diabetes. Well, undoubtedly, I never considered all that when I was 4 years old, who wetted his bed every other night and loved Tom and Jerry. No, what I despised most about the white bread was its simplicity and of course the brown crust surrounding its edges. But everybody already knew that. There was no finesse and elegance in such a cuisine, no scrumptious wet juice when you squeeze it, like with roast beef, or even a hint of saltiness similar to cookies. Even when I ate it together with Spam or hot dogs, the bland taste of that simple, moist, solid thing that stuck on the roof of my mouth every chance it could was impossible for me to love. I simply gave up on the starchy carb and the idea that I could never love it or respect the invention of the white bread. However, the inevitable moment arrived, or as I would put it, the fateful encounter, that led me to the moment when I met the white bread again. I was 14 years old, I was in my friend's home, and we had just finished watching a horror movie. We were frightened but very hungry, so my friend asked their helper at home to prepare afternoon snacks for us. She immediately got right to it. Using one of her hands, she pulled something from the pantry. To my surprise, it was a gardenia white bread, and there and then, I knew that I had to suck everything up and face the white bread once again. However, the wonderful helper was not finished. She grabbed another item inside the pantry. It was the infamous Nutella. I have only heard of tales about Nutella. They said it was a very luscious, thick, smooth, and creamy. Due to my father's diabetes, my mother avoided Nutella, so this was my first encounter with it. The helper took a butter knife and scooped a generous portion of Nutella, from the jar and spread it across the bread, left, right, up, and down. It was the most angelic thing I ever saw. It was thick and smooth as melted butter. She was able to spread a generous amount of Nutella on the entire yeast sponge without any trouble. And she sandwiched it with another white bread. Afterwards, she chopped off the brown crust or off the gardenia white bread. At that very moment, I overlooked everything from the past, every negative affiliation with the white bread I had. I bottled all those feelings up and welcomed the plate of Nutella white bread with open arms. I remember staring at it for a while, checking it out, and it was really time for me again to eat the white yeast. Eventually, I took a bite out of the square thing and never in my wildest dream could I ever thought that it was that good. The sweet chocolatey Nutella with the weird texture of the white bread made it very easy to chew, and the lusciously smooth, creamy chocolate melted my mouth. It was a match made in heaven. I ate the entire thing without even batting an eye. After that fateful encounter, I tried white bread again. I experimented with different spreads like Lady's Choice Mayonnaise, Cheese Whiz, Reno Liver Spread, and I realized that the unhealthy sponge yeast I had avoided all my childhood was not so bad after all.
And we'll be back before you know.
Hey, Ren.
Yeah?
Do you want to grab a coffee in the, you know, usual place?
Sure, I'd love to.
Yeah?
I'll just go home quickly and change.
Right.
See you in 30 minutes.
Okay.
Friends, they are the people who cherish you and will be with you no matter what. They shape you into the best version of yourself, which is why... You wouldn't want to disobey your best friends, would you?
Okay. That worked.
Hi, my name is Priscilla Ordonez of the Creative Writing Stream. I will be reading an excerpt from my work called DLSU-IS. As Anthony Bourdain once said, good food is very often, even most often, simple food. This essay talks about my family's simple tradition of the untouched queso de bola and the humble pancit during Christmas and New Year. It combines two genres of creative nonfiction, the personal essay and the food writing, since this two can organically combine memory and personal life experiences. Everyone, this is the DLSU-IS. Our Christmas dinner isn't grand. It's a simple meal with family and a few guests. Since most of the people are old, the food fits the palate of the elders. In our long rectangular table, the centerpiece would always be the queso de bola. Every time this type of cheese is released for purchase, my family would end up hoarding these things and it would almost last for another year. No one really touches it at dinner time, but it is always there, sliced up in case someone wants some of it. The popular dish for the elders is the pancit. With their soft gums, this is something that's easy for them to chew, but it's savory and tasty. The pancit would always be placed on the left side of the table, so no kids will be seen on that side. The right side of the table is something that the younger kids will enjoy, spaghetti with little cut up hot dogs. The spaghetti sauce will always be something I would always smell first as soon as I enter the house. The sweet and savory smell of the sauce combined with the moist wheat smell coming from the pasta. I remember doing paunahan for the hot dog since I knew my brother and my cousins would devour them. I don't know if it's a Filipino thing, but the food served in Christmas dinner would also be served in New Year's dinner. And there it is again, the mahiwagang queso de bola. Since it's round, it has to be there along with other fruits that would bring good luck to the coming year. For 16 years, I got used to this kind of Christmas and New Year. It feels right, but during last year's quarantine, Christmas was boring and New Year was quieter. The food was much tastier and fancier and all, but it didn't feel right. I hope this year my family and I can go back to the way we've experienced Christmas and New Year. But it seems that the Delta variant has other plans. Everyone, thank you for listening.
Hello, I am Rodrigo Manuel from the Creative Writing Stream. For class, we were asked to write an essay about a place that evokes certain thoughts, feelings, or memories. My work combines the characteristics of personal essay, which highlights a person's memories and experiences, and the travel essay, which uses sensorial descriptions and vivid imagery. While other writings about place talk about extravagant vacation trips in faraway exotic places, I chose to write about a regular place nonetheless filled me with childhood nostalgia, sadness, and maybe a little bit of regret. This is reminiscing about a brat in a playground while I stare at my computer screen. Festival Mall in Alabang, a generic place filled with people bustling about, siren noises from rides, beakers from every angle, interesting and colorful stores, and boring walks at clothing stores. But Pixie Forest is a place he always goes to with his brothers, surrounded by children full of excitement like him. He remembers flashing lights from screens, kids screeching because they are not tall enough to ride bumper cars. A ride imitating a log splashing and the sound of colliding hockey game around the corner. This is the place for impatient kids, for memories to build, for enjoying childhood. This is this place the brat would always go to. A playground filled with mats, foams, and obstacle courses. This place can only be entered with socks on to avoid ruining the precious mats. It is humongous, I tell you, with a decent number of children too. The brat makes sure that the other kids will not have a chance to bump into him, since his past experience was not bright at all. Kids learn. They know when danger happens. They are not that naive. Every time when the parents return, this fella says, "This is home. I want to stay longer. Please stop. I wish to come back." That brat never wanted to let go of happiness. It was his only paradise. The artificial trees and the imitation of wooden chairs and tables overwhelmed him with desire. He had been to many playgrounds, but that one was special. As I stare at the screen, typing, I look down and notice that the pattern of my desk is like pixie forest. I am reminded of the fact that I am too old to go back. The fact that the little brat wanted to grow up quickly and join his brothers throws me in and stings me like a thumbtack in my chest. I didn't know growing up was leading me further away from Pixie Forest. I stopped typing. I stopped looking. I clenched my fist. The kid looked up, captured the sight of the castle, team's bountiful colors, and the roller coaster running. He never thought that those things would all end soon. But it is okay. I'm glad he enjoyed them to the fullest. The lucky brat.
A virus has been discovered circulating around the world
as a result of the outbreak of city or entire region
a month ago, and scientists
say the threat has subsided or blown over.
Jason, what are we?
Oh, babe, don't tell me you've caught feelings. You're nothing to me.
If you aren't ready, that's fine with me.
I'll see you later for dinner. Yeah?
Yes. Let's see you later.
Seriously? That's who you replaced me with?
Guys, here now at Alfredo's Dining. Today, we're gonna have a taste of two of their signature recipes. First, their pancit guisado with lumpiang Shanghai and their fruit salad. So, let's taste.
I've missed you.
Hey. I've missed you too.
Go fuck yourself.
New York is my dream!
Shit!
Pagawa mo yan? May report pa daw kayo bukas, sabi ni Aga?
Bahala na. Kaya na ni Nabogs yun. Basta, kasama ko mamaya.
Sige ah. Sunduin ka namin ng 6:30.
Every time that I work on my pieces, I learn something new. Not only with the process or materials that I use, but also with my own skills and capabilities. In the middle of the process, I realized the potential that I hold in creating these pieces. There are even times where I thought that I am finished, but after a while, I get back to work again and add a few more elements to the work. More often than not, I am shocked with every final output that I create, as it either looks exactly like how I envisioned it to be, or sometimes even looks better. I discovered that the opinion that should matter to me the most must come from me, because I am the person who conceptualized it, and I am the person that knows exactly how it should look like. And that is all. Thank you.
I never knew that I could do wire sculptures until now, because I have never imagined myself doing it. I have seen such sculptures on museums and other places where it is displayed, especially when I was young, and for me it looks so complex to make, so I have never really thought that I would make one in the future. But now that I have done it, and for me it is successfully done because I'm satisfied with how it turned out and how it looked, so I realized that you would never really know what you can do until you decide to try and do it. For us artists, especially the creators of the artwork, it gives us those glimpses of realizations whenever we create our crafts. And for me, this art piece has taught me to not limit ourselves with what we can and cannot do, and that it's better to try new things than to wonder if you could ever really do it.
I discovered, even after all the late nights and pain I've endured, I'm willing to do this for the artwork and see the somewhat finished product. I also realize I love seeing the progress I make along the way and trying to constantly better myself through every artwork I make. I have learned that as an artist, even through adversity, art will guide us through it, and to trust in the process. I honestly feel that DLSU-ADT, with the friends, family, and teachers that I've made, it truly helped me become a better artist.
While working on my artwork, I realized that I had grown exponentially. I now see myself and my potential in a completely different light, and all of that unhesitantly translates into my pieces. I've learned that my primary goal in creating my artworks isn't about being aesthetically pleasing or striving for perfection. I'm not concerned with someone's reaction to being amazed at my work. That said, I aspire as an artist to tell a story, touch the heart, make someone think, and create a sense of mystery. The most important thing I found out about myself is that I can indeed do this. I am doing this. At times, whenever I create those works of mine, I have pretty much convinced myself that I couldn't do it, that I would never be what I envisioned myself being. But now, I know for a fact that I can.
I learned that as an artist, I have way more willpower than I give myself credit for. Whenever I make a piece, I always think, well, yeah, anyone could do it. It's just a matter of practice, really, and just a matter of studying. And while that's still kind of true, it's not really what matters at the end of the day. What matters is that it was me who was willing to put in the effort and the practice. And with a piece of this size and effort, it really forced me to acknowledge the fact that there's really no one else who would do it. There was really no one else that could or would do this. It was me because there was something I wanted to express, and it was something I wanted to prove to myself that I could do. Well, yes, someone else could have made this piece. The point was that they didn't and I did. And that's really just what it is. In a way, it reminds me that there are things that only I would do. And I think that's what makes it special to me. Thank you.
Good day, everyone. I am Rachel Megan Ramos from the Creative Writing Stream. The excerpt I am about to read is from a short personal essay that tries to incorporate elements of literary journalism. Literary journalism is a genre of creative nonfiction that combines the literary techniques of fiction with the preoccupation of journalism about relevant or socio-political issues. My essay is primarily a personal essay, since it tackles my own thoughts, experiences, and opinion on a particular subject matter. But I hope that it also sheds light on the topic of privilege and class hierarchy, which we Lasallians have become even more familiar with during this time. This is Little High, Little Low. I, in my own heaven, am safe from the rain. It cannot touch me. After a day of online school, I don't even realize it has rained. I, who am currently living in Taguig, left Melbourne in December 2020. I have not come back since. With thunderbolts and lightning, Fabian came and wreaked havoc in the Philippines. But I, in my condominium, remain unsolid. Ha! We do not encounter power interruptions or blackouts. I, who left Melbourne in December 2020, have forgotten the terrors of typhoon in my former hometown. Melbourne, home of Pansit Melbourne, is also home to heavy floods. My old house existing when my mom was young stands 3 stories high. Even so, rainwater would leak from the windows and rooftop. I am no longer there to experience it. My presence matters very little to the strangers in Melbourne who can only worry about their day-to-day survival. The thunders continue to rumble and shake the vulnerable shelters of the poor, but the condominium I live in stand firm and the pitter-patter of rain are barely heard. The rain has entered and swept the houses of many Melbournians, but in my room, only a small leak is to be seen. The triangle is said to be the strongest shape in geometric terms. But socially speaking, it is appalling to think that the highest peak doesn't even remember the base from which it stands. Once again, Little High, Little Low by yours truly, Rachel Ramos. Thank you.
Good day, everyone. This is Charlize Esquivel of the Creative Writing Stream. The work I will share with you today is a personal essay. It shows the kind of vulnerability, honesty, and nuance needed to write any kind of creative nonfiction, particularly memoirs and personal essays. There's a pact between the writer and reader in creative nonfiction, a pact that says, I can be honest with you and not hide behind made-up scenarios and details, because I trust you with this truth, and I think you will recognize this truth too. So on behalf of the Creative Writing Stream, thank you for listening to our works. This is A Bad Kid. Teachers always favored the good children. These were the kids who were polite and well-mannered, always raising their hands in class, always giving the right answers. They were angels to the adults' eyes. Looking back, I can assure you I was no angel. A friendless kid with average grades and below average behavior. All my classmates and teachers saw me for what I was. A child who causes trouble and shows disrespect. A bad child. I would draw in the middle of class, which the teachers hated. I would do weird things during lectures, which would distract the other kids. I would go parts of the school restricted to kids because I was curious. I would eat during classes. Small things that piled and piled into a big mess. But among all these memories of that time, the one that stands out the most was a hot Sunday in Pasita, paired with a cold Monday classroom. On Sunday, I came along with my tito to run errands, when I walked by a man who sat in front of a bake shop. On his shoulder, a dirty pink bag. On the top of his head, frizzy brown hair, and his face covered in soot. The people around him were cleaner than he was, and either ate pastries from the bake shop or waited for a tricycle. I tugged on my tito's sleeve, asking for 20 pesos, and running to the front of the bakery after receiving the orange bill. I spent all of it on bread and ran just to give it to the man, who spoke no words but smiled and accepted the bread. On Monday, I entered the classroom for a lesson on Christian values. The teacher walked in, and we met her with a greeting and a bow. I don't recall what came before or what the purpose of the question was, but she asked us, "What good deed have you done this weekend?" My classmates were standing up with answers such as washed the dishes or made my mother coffee. Before I knew it, it was my turn to answer. What good deed have you done this weekend? The classroom anticipated what I had to say. Once again, the teacher asked, what good deed have you done this weekend? Did you not do anything good? I sat back down without a word. Now you might be asking, why didn't you say anything? But the answer was obvious. Why would I say something nobody would believe? To To this day, I still look back on that day, wondering what the outcome might have been. Maybe if I said it, I'd have received the point. But then again, they'd probably think I was lying. I was a bad kid after all.
Hey, I need your help in calculus. Can I get another low grade?
If you can't comprehend this, then I'd rather do it on my own.
This has a huge chunk in our grade.
Dear Diary.
Dear Diary.
Dear Diary. I don't know. I guess I'm gonna try and
do something today.
Even just a simple thing.
ANYAG is the Agusan Manobo word for beauty. Through this online program, we have witnessed the aesthetic allure and artistry in the creative outputs of our consistently developing and maturing grade 12 Lasallian Arts and Design Track students. With the thorough guidance from your teachers and your hard work, dear students, this online event has come to fruition. Now that we are on our second year of quarantine brought by the pandemic, you have proven steadfastly that even with the distance and virtuality of our current educational setup, away from the classroom, art studio, and the rehearsal room, teaching, learning, and creating art are still possible. The talent through your creative output that you have shown today is a promise for a creative future. Continue to harness your skills and gift in the arts through the Arts and Design Track program. And always put in your heart faith, service, and communion and mission that you learned from our beloved De La Salle University. As artists and Lasallians, always keep your eyes open to the realities of your time and use the power of art to speak on matters that needed to be heard and create embodiment of power for the weak and powerless. To quote our national artist for theater, Amelia La Peña Bonifacio, she said, "Truly, art is powerful, and its role is not only to empower the self, but most importantly, to empower others." Congratulations, and I hope for a restful and safe academic break for all of you. Thank you.
Hail, hail, Alma Mater, hail to De La Salle. We'll hold your banner high and bright, a shield of green and white. We'll fight to keep your glory bright, and never shall we fail. Hail to thee, our alma mater, hail, hail, hail. Hail, hail, alma mater, hail.
shield of green and white, we'll fight to